Good morning, church. All right. Hey, we're excited to worship. If you're ready, let's go ahead and stand up and let's begin to sing. Thank our Lord who has saved us. Celebrate what he's done on the cross. And let's just give him all our worship this morning.
Praises rising, eyes are turning to you. We turn to you. Hope is stirring, hearts are yearning for you. We long for you. When we see you, we find strength to face the day. And in your presence, all our fears are washed away. They're washed away. Hosanna, Hosanna, you are the God who saves us. Worthy of all our praises. Hosanna, Hosanna. Come have your way. Come have your way among us. We welcome you here, Lord Jesus. Hear the sound. Turn to you. In your kingdom, broken lives are made new. Oh, you make us new. Cause when we see you, we find strength to face the day. Your presence, all our fears are washed away. They're washed away. Come on now, Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna. You are the God who saves us, worthy of all our praises. Let's surrender to him this morning.
Continue on that. Because when we see him,
we find strength to face the day.
Aren't you glad for that? He gives us strength.
In your presence, all our fears are washed away.
Because when we see you,
we find strength to face the day. Your presence, all our fears.
can be seated and draw your attention up to our baptistry.
She's gonna be baptized today. Thomas is sick today. He was excited about baptizing Maddie, but he's not here today, and I get the privilege of doing that. So again, if you know Maddie and you're a friend of Maddie's, stand up right now if you would. Look at all the youth. My mom and dad are over here. Anyway, let me ask you an important question, Maddie. Have you asked Jesus to come into your heart?
Yes, sir.
Then I want to baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Buried with Christ and raised to walk in newness of life. Amen.
Amen. Let's stand back together and keep on worshiping and celebrating what we just saw, a picture of what Christ does for us. And as we think about the events that we celebrate this week, and we remember the cross, we remember what Jesus did for us. So let's thank him for the cross.
Thank you, Jesus, for the blood.
glorious light.
Let's sing glory to his name.
Glory to his name.
Remain standing for our scripture reading at this time, and we're going to have our 5th and 6th grade girls class come up and lead us in that scripture reading.
Hi, we're the 5th and 6th grade girls. This is Aubrey, Hollis, Lexi, Ellie, and Hallie, and Ms. Shanna is our teacher. We are reading 1 Thessalonians chapter 3 through 8 through 13.
Verse 8, deacons likewise must be dignified, not double-tongued, not addicted to much wine, not greedy for dishonest gain. They must hold the mystery of the faith with a clear conscience.
Also, let them also be tested first, then let them serve as deacons if they prove themselves blameless. Their wives likewise must be dignified, not slanderers, but sober-minded, faithful in all things.
Let deacons each be the husband of one wife, managing their children and their own households well. For those who serve well as deacons gain a good standing for themselves and also have, and also great confidence in the faith that is in Christ Jesus.
This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Lord, thank you so much for this day. Thank you that we could all gather together to worship you. Thank you for the hope that we can have today, that you will give us happiness and just fulfill us. Amen.
Appreciate you. Morning. You doing well? Jarrett, you look so good in that sport coat. Don't get used to it. Yeah. Thank you, guys. Hey, if you didn't know, today is a lot of things. Had a baptism. It's our favorite thing to do here. And we got to read the word, and I always love it when kids read for us, because that's really important for us to realize that kids are not the future of the church. Now, they are not the word, but they are a thank you. And so they're with us today. We're having family worship, and we get to do several things. Three new deacons today, and the reason that we're doing this in morning service is we want everybody to be here for it. So historically, by and large, at least in my experience, this has been kind of like a Sunday night thing or a Wednesday night thing and not been part of the Lord's Day worship. But to me, it's such a biblical concept. We're going to look at why it is. But I wanted us all to witness what happens. And also, and I'm just going to say it out loud here, kids that are in here, I want you to look at what happens. I want you to think in your mind, one day, I want to begin right now orienting my life in such a way that one day I will too be in spiritual leadership in some capacity, right? So I want to do all this together as a faith family. So here's what I want to do. I want to give you a handful of announcements that are really important. And then I want us to spend a few moments in prayer, just kind of getting our hearts and minds aligned. Then I want to open up this text briefly and show us what it means for there to be spiritual leadership in our lives and show how these are the qualifications for deacons, but ultimately they're really just things that every believer should be shooting for. And what a deacon is just somebody who's, by God's grace, doing their best to meet those qualifications. The church sets them aside, not on a pedestal, but actually as a servant. And then we're going to close and we're going to put our hands on, that sounds weird, we're going to lay our hands on some new deacons. We're going to pray for them. You're going to pray for them. And then we're going to take communion together. And it's going to be a really meaningful moment. That sound good? Cool. So there's our roadmap for today. First thing, there, if you're on the front row, because there's no row in front of you, you should have had a little white card. And then for everybody else, there should be a chair in front of you, and there's a little white card in there. Here's what I would like for you to do. Do not take your notes on that. Take your notes on the worship folder. That little thing is going to be really cool, and you'll see more of it next week because we're going to have some cool photo ops for you for Easter. And so what I would like for you to do is, if you would, take that little card and write one of two things. Either your favorite attribute of God or your favorite name of God. One of the two. Your favorite attribute of God, your favorite name for God. And just leave it in your chair afterwards, and we'll pick those up and we'll use those, and you'll understand how they'll be used next week. So make sure you do that. If you forgot my instructions, ask your neighbor. If they didn't hear me, tell your row to pay attention. Our eggs in the outfield thing is tonight. And it's not at the Swartz Rec, not outfield. I said it wrong, and I intentionally tried to say it right. Eggs in the end zone. End zone. Sorry. Thanks, Jay. Eggs in the end zone. So it's not at the Swartz Rec. It's actually at East Ouachita Middle School. So we're moving that over here. We feel like that campus might work a little bit better for us. So invite somebody and come help us. Invite somebody and come help us. It's going to be great. So we'll have fun. There'll be food trucks. By the grace of God, because we are Baptists, by the way. And then our Easter services are next week. So if you show up at 9:30, you're not going to show up when the first service starts. So make sure you map that out with your family. And you should also invite somebody to that. So we'll have two services, and it'll be great, and it'll be a fun day. And last thing is this. And I read this every week because I want this to become part of our heartbeat and who we are. To all who gather this Lord's Day, to anyone weary or heavy laden, to all who were tired and anxious, burdened and broken, this church family gladly welcomes you this day in the name of Jesus Christ, our prophet, priest, and king, the friend of sinners and our only hope in life and death. Our hope is that you see in us the supremacy of Christ, the centrality of the gospel, the unity of the body, and the urgency of our mission. Our prayer is that the Lord will, in his grace, save those who are lost and disciple those who are saved. This Lord's Day, we welcome you because in the gospel, God has welcomed us. So I just want to give you a few brief moments just to mentally transition into what we're about to do, which is to open the text together. And we're not just opening any book. We're opening the Word of God for it to speak to us and for God to change our hearts based upon the things that he says. So take a few moments, prepare your mind and your heart, and then we'll continue with our service. Father, help our minds and our hearts to be positioned correctly in front of you. Father, we enter this room, and God, we know that you care much more about the position of our heart than the position of what we're wearing or whatever else. Father, we've gathered here to worship the risen Christ. We've come together by your grace and your kindness to be able to corporately participate in something that is really, really special and that's been going on for centuries and millennia. God, thank you that you have sustained the church all of these years, and God, we trust that you will continue to sustain the church. Your word says that even the gates of hell won't prevail against it. In other words, it's bulletproof. It's indestructible. So God, we trust that. We trust that you protect us, that you watch over us, and that you care for us. And one of the ways in which you do that is you put leadership in the church, not as a place of power or authority, but as a place of service, because God, ultimately, what a leader is someone who just mimics the life of Christ, and Christ was the ultimate leader, and he's the ultimate servant. God, help us to see, to treasure what it is that you say to us and how our lives should be different. In Jesus' name, amen. So again, got our kiddos with us. If you hear some extra noises, we're just gonna consider those extra praises to the Lord. So get out your Bible, you're gonna need it. Go to 1 Timothy. 1 Timothy, it's right before 2 Timothy. If that helps you out any. We're gonna be in chapter 3. So Paul was writing to this young pastor, and he was telling him, hey man, there's some things going on in the community around you, and there are folks believing things that are not true. And so there are some misconceptions that people have. There are some false teachings. There's some people who are trying to take their beliefs and intermix them into the gospel, and they're trying to essentially leverage people's ignorance into self-gain, into some, again, it'll call it sordid gain in the text. But essentially, there was a group of people that were trying to infiltrate the church, and they were doing so by false teaching. And so you'll notice this as you read through Scripture. There is a constant battle between orthodoxy, which is just the right and true practice of what we believe, and then people who bring in false ideas. And so Paul is constantly bringing back, you have to be sure, you have to be sure, you have to be sure, you have to be sure that you believe what is right, because it is so easy to believe things that are wrong, right? And that applies to just every place in life. But when you make yourself a part of a church, when you submit yourself to the leadership in a church, what you're saying is that the very thing that epistemologically I find to be the highest, greatest moral good, the highest spiritual good, the thing that I find that I am hanging my hat on, that I'm saying I believe this more than anything else, teach me what the book says about what our deepest held beliefs are, that must be a pretty big deal, right? And so you need people who know what they're talking about when they open the book. You need leaders who follow the instructions of the book. You need people who model this and do this, not that you look to them and go, oh, they're great and they have it figured out. No, as a matter of fact, you're looking at people who, by God's grace, have grown and have a little bit of spiritual maturity, and they are trusting and leaning in hard that they are still a sinner, but yet God has graciously helped them and grown them, and by his grace, he will continue to do so. And that's why we have leadership in churches, right? And so there's two offices in Scripture. There's overseers and elders, and those are side by side. And then underneath that, you have deacons. And I use the word underneath like tongue in cheek, because they're both spiritual leaders and they both have spiritual qualifications. And the only difference in the two is elders and overseers teach, and they do everything else a deacon does, but their primary responsibility is teaching. Why? Because if we begin to teach things that are wrong, we'll drift off into things that make us essentially not a church anymore. Because a church is what the Bible defines it as a church. It's not a social organization. It's nothing else. It is the bride of Christ who follows his word, who worships him and does things by his word, right? And so if you'll read right before this, it talks about the qualifications of overseers and elders. And then it says right after that, here are the qualifications for deacons. And this is interesting, and you should pay really close attention to this. He is setting up leadership in the church very clearly as a way of pointing to false teachings in the church and saying you need to have people who teach and they need to have time to make sure that they are prepared to do that and that they are devoting themselves, like Acts chapter 6, to the ministry of the word. And then we studied this a few weeks ago when Stephen and the rest of the first deacons were put into that position. They were ordained into that position. Essentially what they were saying is these men have spiritual characteristics that put them in leadership, and they are literally leading by serving, and they're doing this because there are things that the elders and overseers need to do. And if they spend all their time doing everything else, they will not devote themselves to the ministry of the word. And then there will be a massive lack of understanding, a lack of biblical application. And if that falls apart, everything falls apart. Right? So this is what leads us to this moment. And this is what it says at the very beginning. The Bible actually doesn't say a whole lot about deacons, but you know what it does say? You know what 99% of all of the texts point to about leadership in the church? It's not their giftings. It's not their social position. You know what it is? It's their spiritual characteristics. It's their character. Because God is far more concerned with who you are than what you do. What you do is important. But God is far more concerned with changing your heart and making you a different person than just your mere abilities, because he's God. He can do what he wants, right? Howard Hendricks said this. He was a really famous seminary professor. He said, "The greatest crisis in the world today is a crisis of leadership, and the greatest crisis of leadership is a crisis of character." And here's the thing that I really want you to get. Like, if you've come today and you've gone, well, I'm not going to be a deacon, so I can just tune out. Good try. You can't. The thing about this text is this. These are not things that other people are exempt from. This is actually one of the places where it puts together a list of things that it's not trying to just push morality. It's not saying just grit your teeth and do better. And if you're not doing these things, I'm going to slap you on the face and you just need to move forward. That's not what it's saying. It's saying that by God's grace, as people grow, these are the things that are tangible that begin to grow out of their life in a real and concrete fashion. You with me so far? All of us need to be aiming for this. All of us need to be aiming for what goes on in this text. This is not limited to just leaders. And here's the thing. I want to make this so abundantly clear. You're going to be tired of me saying this by the end of the day. We are not putting people before you. Like when the deacons, all the whole group of them, stand up here later, what we are not saying is these men are perfect, because they're not. And you know that. And their spouses know that. Don't say amen. But like anybody that stands up in leadership says, God has called me to this responsibility, and by his grace, I will walk in it. And how I walk in this is, I'm going to pay attention to growing, because healthy things grow. I'm going to submit myself to the Lord, and I'm going to submit myself to you in service. Because literally what we're doing today, just to kind of put it all in a nutshell, there's a group of men standing up here that are going to say to you very clearly, I'm here to serve you because God has served me in the gospel. Because of what we see in the gospel, I want to mimic that in my life and serve you. That should be a pretty beautiful thing to you and me, right? Verse 8, check this out. Deacons likewise should be men of dignity. And it says likewise because I just got through talking about overseers and elders. Deacons likewise must be men of dignity, not double-tongued or addicted to much wine or fond of sordid gain. First point's this: spiritual leaders grow in holiness. Spiritual leaders grow in holiness. And all of these things are going to be different ways in which spiritual leaders grow in Christians themselves. Anybody who is following the Lord should grow in these ways. Spiritual leaders grow in holiness. And here's a couple of things that it says. They must be men of dignity. They must not be double-tongued. If you look at that word double-tongued in Greek, what it means literally is the root word is logos, like it's truth. It means don't be double-truthed. Here's a clear example. If you tell somebody something in one room and you go to another room and there's another person, don't say something different to them. What it means is let your yes be yes and your no be no. It means to make sure that you are consistent, that in some way your character is predictable, that we don't have to worry about what's coming out of your mouth, that you're not a loose cannon, right? Anybody ever met loose cannon before? Do not raise your hand, but just mentally raise your hand. Are you the loose cannon? Is it you? Are you the one at Thanksgiving dinner that everybody's really uncomfortable around? The uncle that nobody ever knows what he's going to say? They just make life fun, don't they? Or addicted to much wine or fond of sordid gain. What it means is that they have self-control. People who grow spiritually have self-control. Means that you're controlling your mouth and what comes out of it. And you're controlling your mouth and what goes into it. Right? Not addicted to much wine or fond of sordid gain, which means that if they gain things, if they're successful, it's to help people, and they're not fond of sordid gain. In other words, it's not gain that they shouldn't be having at other people's expense. John Stott, is one of my favorite commentators, said this: some Christians sow to the flesh every day and wonder why they do not reap holiness. Holiness is a harvest. Whether we reap it or not depends almost entirely on what and where we sow. Holiness is a harvest. Whether we reap it or not depends almost entirely on what and where we sow. So I want to ask you a question as we transition into the next point. In your own life, if you were to take an honest account of where you are, where you're tracking with this idea of what it means to be holy and pursue holiness as a Christian, if you were to look at yourself in, let's just pick a random date out of the air, March of 2023, a year ago, like, are you any further along now than you were then? Like, what does your life look like now compared to a year ago, or 2020, or 2015, if you were alive back then? Verse 9, but they must hold to the mystery of the faith with a clear conscience. They hold to the mystery of the faith with a clear conscience. Second thing is this: spiritual leaders grow in wisdom and understanding. Spiritual leaders grow in wisdom and understanding. So this is what this verse is saying. If you're holding to the mystery of the faith with a clear conscience, it means this: there are things we understand and things that we don't understand. And so for the things that God has revealed to us, we're solid on those things. We believe those things. We plant our feet and our roots in those things. And for the things that we can't fully understand, we're still going to trust God for that. We're going to believe what the Bible says, even if there are moments in it that we approach concepts that really blow our mind. A really easy one is the Trinity. Like, I can sit up here and explain to you ad nauseum all the stuff that I've read about the Trinity, and I can just regurgitate to you the things that I have learned about the Trinity, but it doesn't mean that I have a full grasp of the way in which God can be one God yet three persons. And as a matter of fact, I'm really careful how I talk about the Trinity, because It can be really easy to say something wrong about the Trinity trying to teach people about the Trinity, right? Because it's so, and I said this Wednesday night, like probably shouldn't use illustrations for the Trinity because he's not like an egg. Trinity's not like an egg, just not. No eggs in the Trinity. He's not water and vapor and gas or ice or whatever. He's just not. Because even the earliest councils that talked about the doctrinal concept of the Trinity said, it is a mystery that God has revealed to us. And if we believe that God is truly above us, there are going to be things about him conceptually that we just cannot fully wrap our minds around. Right? You don't have to fully understand every nuance of the Lord in order to worship him. The same way in which many people do not understand the full weight of what goes on in the motor in their car, but they still get in it and drive it. And all the non-mechanically inclined people said, knowledge is knowing the right answer, and wisdom is knowing how to apply it to the problem. F.F. Bruce, another really good commentator, said this, wisdom and understanding are gifts of God, but they must be cultivated in order to become effective. Wisdom and understanding are gifts of God, but they must be cultivated in order to become effective. So in your life, what patterns are you intentionally walking in to actively pursue growth and spiritual wisdom? In your life, what practical things, what intentional patterns are you walking in to grow in spiritual wisdom and knowledge? Because the thing is, unless you're intentional, it's not going to happen. Like when we're getting ready for deer season, which starts the day after the previous deer season ends, and we're planting food plots, like food plots don't get planted on hopes and dreams, do they? It takes work. Those limbs don't cut themselves. I can't make it through a sermon without talking about deer hunting. I'm sorry. Verse 10. These men also must first be tested. Let them serve as deacons if they are beyond reproach. In other words, put their feet to the flame. If you see something in them, test them. Put them through the paces. Third point, spiritual leaders have a growing reputation of spiritual maturity. Spiritual leaders have a growing reputation of spiritual maturity. This means that in these guys that we're going to put before you and say, these are the three new deacons that we're ordaining today, and there will be more in the future. And there's also some who are just as qualified that we've not brought forward so far, and that day will be in the future because you can't bring 50 people forward at the same time, because what we did was we decided, hey, we need a certain amount. We decided on the amount. Then we got a group of people and we just started praying over that group and praying over that group and praying over that group. And here's where we landed. And so here's the thing to remember. You don't need a title to serve. You don't need a title or a position to serve. And secondly, just because somebody doesn't have a title doesn't mean that it abdicates their ability to do anything. You remember Matthias? Everybody remembers Matthias' name. Do you remember the guy that didn't get picked? What was his name? Don't feel bad. I had to look it up too. His name was Barsabbas. And they were both qualified. So it's not a thing where we're saying, hey, these guys and these guys alone meet these qualifications. What we're saying is that there are many people that we have already seen these things in, and we've just set these guys aside, and this is where we feel led so far. And in the future, there'll be more. Because as the church grows, so does its need for leadership, right? Spiritual leaders have a growing reputation of spiritual maturity. And if you work on, I said this a few weeks ago, if you work on your character, if you work on who you are, God will take care of your reputation. That's not something you can go out and try to work on intentionally, because if you do, it'll just backfire on you. Last thing is this. And this is going to ruffle some feathers. You ready? Get them ready. Get them ready to get ruffled. Be aware of those feathers, man. Just pluck those feathers. Verse 11. Women must likewise be dignified, not malicious gossips, but temperate, faithful in all things. Deacons must be husbands of only one wife, and good managers of their children and their own households. For those who have served well as deacons obtain for themselves a high standing and great confidence in faith that is in Christ Jesus. Now, if you're reading the ESV or the NIV, it's going to say wives. If you're reading the New American Standard, it says women. If you have a Greek text and you're reading straight from the Greek text, you know what it says? Women. Doesn't say wives. So translate that as you will, because that's not the point of our topic today. Women must likewise be dignified, not malicious gossips, but temperate, faithful in all things. What we have said is we want to make sure that anybody we put forward in leadership, that is a family-oriented thing. That is a family-oriented thing. And it's not one of those places where we can say, well, we feel that you have a problem, but your family does not. Our very best with that. We try so hard, our very best with that. We try so hard to make sure that our kids turn out the way that we want them to. We lay scripture before them. We apologize to them when we mess up. One of the most powerful things you can do as a parent is to apologize to your kids when you make a mistake, because the thing is, you never want to put before them the idea that you think you're perfect. Because if you are a sinner and I'm the exact same way. But if I see my parents think they're perfect, I gotta be perfect. You with me so far? If your kids walk away, just want to help you with that. I've had so many parents come to me over the years, especially in student ministry, and they come to me just broken. My kid walked away and it's my fault. You may have played a part in that, but they have to make their own decisions. In the same way that a completely wayward parent can end up with a kid who loves and treasures Jesus, you can't have it both ways. So let God's grace just be obvious in that situation. What I'm really getting at here is verse 12. Deacons must be husbands of only one wife and good managers of their children and their own households. Do you know what it doesn't say? This is the feather ruffling part. It doesn't say that husbands manage their wives. It doesn't say that husbands manage their wives. It says deacons must be husbands of only one wife. It says literally a one woman man. And good managers of their children and their households. So what it means is, and if we look over at Ephesians, when it talks about husbands and wives, that they are mutually submissive, because this entire thing about deacons is servants. The entire idea of a deacon is a servant. The literal definition of deacon is servant. It means to be mutually submissive. Yes, men are the leaders in their households, but they lead by serving. This is a team effort. Husbands don't lord any kind of authority over their spouses. Husbands don't manage their wives. There's been this huge misunderstanding for a very long time with many, many people that says that husbands need to be the guys that point the finger and say, you do this and you do that, and women should just do whatever they're told. That is not what Scripture says. You with me? Deacons must be husbands of only one wife and good managers of their children and their own households. For those who have served well as deacons obtain for themselves a high standing and great confidence in faith that is in Christ Jesus. You know what this means? This means that people who serve their families will be really good at serving other people. People who serve their families will be really good at serving other people. Because here's the thing, here's why I know this, here's why I'm so confident about this. Because in Ephesians, who is it that is supposed to mimic Christ to the spouse? The husband. The husband is called to mimic Christ to their spouse. Husbands, we should be the smile of Christ to our spouses. You with me so far? In the same way that Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her, husbands are supposed to mimic that in the way that we treat our wives. And so here's the thing about deacons, which seamlessly leads us in to this point. Spiritual leaders grow in leadership at home. Spiritual leaders grow in leadership at home. Because if you lead at home, you can lead outside the home. But if you don't lead in your own home, you can't lead outside your home. Because that's where everything has to start. Last thing is this, and we'll be done with this particular portion. If you got your Bibles, flip over to Mark 10. We'll be in verse 43. Mark 10, verse 43. But whoever would be great among you must be your servant. Same exact word is used right here. It is used in 1 Timothy about deacons. And whoever would be first among you must be slave of all. For even the Son of Man, so even Christ himself, came not to be served but to serve. The literal translation of this text, if you were to read this in Greek, says, for even the Son of Man came not to be deaconed, but to deacon. Because deacon can be a noun and a verb. And to give his life as a ransom for many. If you want to know what this whole like organizational chart, as it were, for the church goes, is that there are overseers and elders. There are deacons, and anybody in leadership, their primary responsibility is to be Christ to other people, is to say, I want to serve you. We are not on a pedestal. We are actually kneeling before you saying, God has set us aside, and so has the church, to serve you. To be the embodiment of Philippians chapter 2, which is to consider others more important than ourselves, to be subservient to other people. And that's why leaders don't need special treatment. That's why I'm never going to have a special parking space outside. So there's on the back of your note page, there is a kind of a prayer guide for our deacons, our new deacons. And I've kind of written a few things I would love for us just to pray for these guys. And here's the thing. You need to pray these for all of our leaders. You need to pray this for all of our deacons. And here's the thing, too. If you miss this, you miss everything. If you miss this, you miss everything. All we're trying to do is just point everything that we're doing back to Christ because he is the ultimate servant. So we model our lives after him. Does that make sense? So we model our service after him in our homes, and so we serve one another as a way of saying, in the gospel, Christ has served me, so I'm going to serve my spouse. Wives with husbands, husbands with wives, parents with children, children with parents. Outside of our homes, we're going to do this with our coworkers, with our family, even the goofy uncle that makes Thanksgiving weird. We're going to model service, and this is the way that this service is modeled in the church. Father, thank you so much that so long ago you wrote these things through your servant Paul. And God, in 2024, they are just as needed. Father, there's nothing that you wrote that's outdated. There's nothing that's been given to us as revelation from your hand that is not completely and totally useful for us today. And God, we just, as we move into a time of giving and of response, Father, we just want to do this in such a way as to say to you, God, in the gospel, you have served us. In the gospel, you have given us Jesus. And so, God, as a response, we give ourselves to you and we give ourselves to other people in service. God, thank you so much for being so kind and gracious to us and not only redeeming people who sinned against you, but giving us responsibility in your kingdom. God, help us to realize just how deep of a truth that really is and how weighty that really is. We bless you and we treasure you. In Jesus' name, amen. Would you stand with us? The deacons are gonna take up our offering. We'll be down here to pray with you if you'd like for us to pray with you. You just respond however you would like to. Thank you.
place at the foot of the cross. I once was lost, but now I'm found, and all my chains fall to the ground. So take this life, I lay it down at the foot of.
Be seated. So would our deacons and new deacons come to the front? So what we're going to do for just a minute is the biblical model of setting aside people for leadership is extremely simple. After you do what we just read in the text, I'm in the way, sorry. After you do what you do in the text, after you set them aside, after they go kind of through this process of making sure that we know that they're who we think they are and they're not phony, that we just pray for them. And here is what I would really just encourage you to do. In this moment, don't lose the gravity of what we're doing. We're not just sitting here observing. Like, you as a faith family get to participate. Like, you get to pray for these guys, and you get to pray for them that God would use them, protect them, use them as an example. Children in the room, I would encourage you to do the same thing. And here's something I would add to your prayer, that you would ask God, hey, would you prepare me for spiritual leadership in the future? That God would one day use you as he's already using you, but one day he would grow you into that leadership as well. So we got a handful of guys here. So this is Jason Norris and Miss Amanda. And this is Steve Dark and Carol. And way down there, we got Doug and Lauren Nielsen. So these are the folks we're putting before you. And so just you'll be able to know them by name. And if you didn't know them before, you can put a name with a face. And you're not praying for this guy saying he's Doug. So so if you want to grab that piece of paper, we're just going to spend some moments up here praying. And you sit where you are, spend some time praying yourself, and then we'll let you know when to transition into the next part of the service. So y'all can sit down now. Resurrection.
satisfaction. Why should I gain from his reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know with all my heart. His words have paid my ransom. Why should I gain from his reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know with all my heart. His wounds have paid my ransom. May the words of my
Lord, we are just spending a moment just as a church, God, and collectively we're all asking you the same thing. We're in thankfulness for people that we love, just asking you to use them, but God, also to continue to use this church to reach this community. God, to use our deacon body to serve the church within. And God, we're also just looking to you, the ultimate deacon, the ultimate servant, saying we want to model everything we do after you and who you are and what you've done for us. And God, all of this collectively just saying we are so thankful for a God like you who not only takes care of us, but God, in even just very tangible and practical ways, God, gives us things to do like ordaining deacons. For God, setting into motion things so long ago that can't be outlived and can't be outdated. That God, you knew what you were doing. That God, when you say you're sovereign, you're actually sovereign. So God, thank you so much for just the beauty of this moment that we get to share together. And thank you for our kids being with us. Thank you for our church gathering together. And God, we do pray for all of the men up here. That God, we would serve you well and serve your church well. And that God, you would continue to walk with us in unity. Help us to model Christ in our behavior and the way that we treat each other and the way we speak about each other and how we move forward as your people who just genuinely, with all of our energy, just genuinely want to love you well and to love our community well. So God, just move through us and in us and help us to know what to do, where to go, and how to do it, Father. We are truly your servants. In Christ's name, amen. So last thing, like we do every week, grab your communion cup. So I think we got some up here somewhere. At least I hope we do. I've been instructed to tell you to kind of shake it a little bit, like chocolate milk. All right, you can stop now. All things would care enough about people like you and me that he would send Jesus for us, that he would be a servant to us and the level of sacrifice that he is to us. And so ultimately any of these things that we're doing are just mirrors of the gospel. We're just literally taking what Christ did for us and modeling those intangible ways to people around us. And you know one thing about the early church, you've been in the book of Acts for a while, you know the one thing thing about the early church that's markedly different than us is that they didn't have to go out and tell people about Jesus. People came to them. You want to know why? Because they saw something remarkably different about the church. Every account we have of people sharing about Jesus is someone coming to them and going, the community of people you live in is so markedly different than everything else I've seen. I want to be part of that. And those are the people that Jesus broke his body for. And the same with the cup. Represents Jesus' blood spilled for you and me. May that never be something that we get tired of hearing about. Each day we sin and each day we need his forgiveness. Father, thank you for just a day we get to celebrate, a day we get to lift you up. God, help us do that every day. We bless you and we treasure you, and thank you for these men that are now set aside for your service, God, even just in an official way. In Christ's name, amen. Got a few instructions for you. Number one, come by and shake their hand, hug their neck. Number two, there'll be a little kind of walk-through reception in the welcome center. So kind of that'll be the general.